So, welcome to the countryside of publishing now. I feel like a person from the deep province talking to the people from the big towns, because we have a university that doesn't have such a wise chair like Athabasca dedicating some funds to publishing. And we have been starting our publishing several years ago. Nevertheless, I think by now that I'm standing here and telling you about the university press in Göttingen is a success in itself. I will quickly talk about the situation of humanities and social sciences in Germany, because that is specific and that also sheds some light why we do what we do. Then I will quickly pass over the university presses in German-speaking Europe and talk about the university press as such, and then reveal what our publication model is, because I've been thinking about what is actually our publication model. As we have seen, the book is still the main medium. The situation in Germany is special again, because our scientists really work within culture-specific and discipline-specific frameworks, which means they will also find the right publishers for it. And that means in Germany that the main scene is dominated by small and medium enterprises, really tiny presses, and usually with a very close relationship between presses and authors. We don't really have any standardized or cross-disciplinary rankings that make it easy to assess money and evaluate whether it works. So open access is still at the beginning in Germany, and we're really happy that OAPEN has already making a stand in the UK and in the Netherlands, and I hope this makes some impact on German funders, because nobody wants to be overtaken from the Netherlands in Germany. So nevertheless, open access is still an experiment, for with the exception of several university presses in Germany. Those are these presses. I will not read them out loud. You can find more information on the website of the working group of the university presses. But here are some figures. So if you want, come visit us at the Frankfurt Book Fair. We have a common stand, which also includes some European university presses. I made an estimation for another presentation of in front of German librarians, and I made up this artificial average university press in Germany. So this press has been founded in the shift of the digitization and with the upcoming of the internet, 1997, produces on average 44 titles per year. This is mainly monographs in the hybrid model, online and print version. And it's almost always under the control of the institution, mostly part of the library. And most of the presses have some control over their income, but not all. Some have no control over their income. And most presses cover some of their costs, some don't cover any of their costs, and some cover a lot of their costs. Most of these presses are defined to be a public service. That means they have some fiscal privilege and they don't pay income tax. And now comes the interesting part, the countryside of publishing. Not even two full-time equivalents. The same goes for my press. We have 2.5 full-time equivalents. Open access is for all of these presses almost a must-do. So 90% of them feel obliged to do open access. And almost half of them make it mandatory. So there's no way out of open access. This is a screenshot, which is several weeks ago. I would have liked to present recent screenshots, but the website of my press is down. So in case you want to check out, it's down, it has been down for several days, and there's nothing that I can do about it. But it's also, I'm not responsible for it, which means I can't do anything about it because somebody else is going to do it. And here's the reason why. Most of you are circumscribed publishers, which means you do everything that needs to be done by a press in your house. I think the best example is Martin, who is doing something else. Martin Rasmussen, who's the example of in-housing everything. And The Göttingen University Press is in-housing some of the things that we do, but most of the things that we do blend into the infrastructure of our institution. So that's our human resources management, housing, IT service. So if my website is down, I can tell somebody, can you please take care of it? And they will say, when your press is on my list on top, I will take care of it. The overhead of our press is covered by the library and by the university. And in this case, it's not because we have a wise president taking this decision, but because the library decided that this is good for the university to do it. And so somehow under the radar, we decided to start a press and that it was good for the university to do open access. We do have some revenues in our press from author fees and book sales. And yes, we can't say authors don't need to pay, although we would like them, but we try to keep the costs down for them by saving money wherever we can, by making use of what is there anyway. What is not covered by the sales is me standing here. So all the academic stuff of the press is away because it's here today. And the organizing of the quality control of peer review and editorial process, we also don't count into our prices because we think this is something that a university should really be responsible for. And as a thumb rule, we do some accounting, even though we don't count it into our prices and not into our author fees or the prices for the book sales. Our university subsidizes each publication by 50%, not because they want it, but we make them do it. And it just starts that they find this reasonable and that it makes sense. We run journals, not because we wanted to, because we decided that we have to stick to books because this is the only thing that we can do as a very small press. And we also decided to do full open access because we couldn't afford anything else. No elegant solution like the National Academy of Science. But these two downturns somehow turn into an advantage these days because we started with open access books and we have been familiar with it for the last almost 10 years now. And because we always decided to do full open access, we don't have to think whether a license, a CC BY license, is going to harm our sales, because we simply decide this is all we can do, and we don't see it from the sides of the sales, but we see it from the side of the author. What is good for the author? When it comes to the publication model, when I look at the product, it's pretty much down to earth. It's PDFs online. If authors want to, they can include enriching elements. We reserve the exclusive rights for the print version. We're quite liberal on the online version. It's available at the publisher's website. It's available at Open, other aggregators. And the online version is basically covered by author fees and the sales of the print copies. The print version, we guarantee that it's in print for the next 5 years. And those costs are covered by revenues through print on demand. To include our titles into OAPEN has been a huge effort for us. Because we're small, because we decided, yes, we are in the countryside of publishing, that means we need to be down to earth and pretty simple. When it comes to the next step, and that's aggregations, that is wide disseminations, we need to do more about it. Because for our authors at the university, what mainly counts is that their stuff is online and that they have their printed books in a nice quality in line with the corporate identity of the university. But we have not started to really develop the full potential of open access, which means the stuff lives online and starts to connect to each other online. So what is our publication model then? And what I finally came up with is we do embedded publishing. We do it in the institution for the institution. So with the talk that Salvatore this morning gave, I can call it my tiny little mini scope 3, that we basically within the institution try to be reasonable and turn around revenues instead of making our authors take the money from one pocket, bring it to the publisher and losing it and let it leave the institution. We try to keep it within the institution and make the costs that are, keep the fees as low as possible so that we don't force our authors to raise funds that the university is going to put from one pocket into the other. And therefore the publishing is not delegated to a circumscribed entity, but it's a node within the network. And that also means that we as the publishers within the institution can change our hats any minute that is needed, which also means that we can recommend an author and say, please stay with your publisher, don't change to us, stay there, but negotiate. Negotiate for better open access conditions. Or that we sometimes also turn down publications, not because we think they are not worth publishing, but because authors have strange ideas what they think is needed, large print runs and everything in offset printing. So we try to keep it simple in order to serve them best. So the usual field of publishing, of this publishing value chain that is covered by public money is this. And when we see the university press model, and I think there's part of it also in the Athabasca model, is that we suddenly spread the funding over the whole circle. But one thing should be kept in mind, we can only publish a small fraction of that that is there anyway. And not everything is right in the university press of an institution. Many things need to be at other publishers, more specialized, more reputation building. But nevertheless, there are several pros for this solution that I see. And that one is that there is a lot of cost saving potential. Not every publication needs 10,000 euros in order to be seen by its target groups. Sometimes the smaller solution is just good enough. And we have very direct services because it's our publishing house in our house. We do some branding for the institution, which is helpful for them. And it also gives them a profile as an institution that does open access and supports open access for all fields, not just for STM. And we don't have the economics in our background for the publishing program, but we can also publish highly specialized publications from within the university. And there are certainly severe downturns. Eleonora can talk about this. If there's a turn of tide in the university, it suddenly affects the press. And sometimes the press even closes down overnight, like Nottingham University Press. We're always in the danger of vanity publishing or meaningless publications because we do serve the institution. But that's a danger for every publisher. And you always need some means to avoid this. The true costs of publishing might be way higher than one thinks, or they might be even unknown. But I think this can be controlled for by a good controlling, and this is what we do. So we do know what we spend and how we are subsidized. But one thing, and I see this is a true downturn of small university presses that are not networked, is that innovation or change is truly difficult due to economy of scale. And the success of the publishing enterprise is then very often relying on very specific circumstances, that there is one person with certain talents, and if that person leaves, the whole press is running the danger of being finished. So I don't really have an answer. That's why there's a white slide. What is the right publication model? What I see is that university presses are one brick in the house of open access, and they might be for some disciplines and for some schools and for some series, some authors, just the right brick. For others, they might be meaningless, but I think there is a role for us, and especially in Germany, because the university presses have gained the experience on open access long before our German Science Foundation has picked up on the idea of funding and supporting open access for books. Thank you.